And this is actually one of the most requested videos. How do I convert effects from VFX Graph to the particle system? And the idea with this video today is to show similarities between these two particle systems and how you can translate your knowledge from one particle system to the other. Personally, I always recommend people, newcomers, to first learn the particle system. It will make your life easier. I actually have these two courses that will definitely help you out to get started. But recently I've only published VFX Graph tutorials and courses. And that's actually when many people began asking, how do I convert VFX Graph to particle system or vice versa? One of the major differences between VFX Graph and the particle system, besides one using the GPU and the other using the CPU, is the fact that one has everything exposed, all its models, they are all there, you can see what everything does and test it out of the box. While in VFX Graph, that doesn't happen. You have these four major blocks, and each one can have several models that you need to search for, and even specific models by region, and each model can receive a different input and work in a different way. So yeah, it gets wild. And visually, that's a major difference. We went from having everything exposed to now having everything on a drop-down menu. But what you really need to remember is that the terms, the terminology, the keywords, they are all the same between VFX Graph and the particle system. So let's actually see a few examples and how you can close that gap between VFX Graph and particle system, and you will see many similarities between them too. Just a quick shout out to our sponsor today, which is Unity, and the Unity Asset Store from time to time has these huge sales, which are really awesome for us developers, so we can get quality assets or tools that kinda help speedrun certain parts when developing a game. This time we have the spring sale, so make sure to check out the link I left below. I'm sure you will find tools or assets that are useful with a good discount. So on this scene I have the exact same effect, which are some sparks. The one on the left, the orange one, is done with the particle system, and the one on the right is done with VFX Graph. On the left, particle system, on the right, VFX Graph. The sparks that are done with the particle system, they have two particle systems, one for the sparks and another one for the flare, which is this little part right here. The same thing is happening on VFX Graph. We essentially have the sparks, a particle system for the sparks, and then another particle system for the flare, that little bright spot in the beginning. Then, on the particle system side, this is continuously spawning particles because the looping is turned on the particle system. And it keeps on spawning particles because we have an emission, a rate over time, 50 particles per second. The same thing happens in VFX Graph. If I go here to the sparks, we have the spawn block up here. It has a constant spawn rate of 75 particles per second, but if we select the spawn block, we also have the loop duration and the loop count options and the delay, which basically are the same things we have here, duration, looping, and start delay. We just can't control the loop count, how many times it loops. And same thing happens in VFX Graph. We could have different types of emissions, like a burst, for example, which is essentially exactly the same thing as this burst down here in the emission model of the particle system. So that's how we take care of the spawn, the emission, the looping, the delay. But now let's see how we control the particle from the beginning. Whenever the particle is born, as you can see in the particle system, we can set a start lifetime, a start speed, which is random, between 2 and 20, and then a start size, and a start color, and gravity as well. All of these properties happen once the particle is created. As soon as the particle is created, it starts with those random values, with one of those random values. And then we can control over the lifetime of the particle some more properties, like the color, for example, like the size, rotation, and so on. We can control a few of those properties over lifetime. And the same thing happens in VFX Graph. Right here we have the initialized particle, which is whenever the particle is created and is not yet seen, not yet rendered. We are going to say things like, for example, it's going to have a lifetime, a velocity, a size, in this case a scale, because there's a little difference here on how we stretch particles compared to the particle system, and a set color, and a start color, basically. And just like in the particle system, these are the properties the particle starts with. However, to control one of those properties over lifetime, it's a bit different. For example, the gravity in VFX Graph is a force that needs to be continuously updated to the particle, each frame, as well as the collision. It needs to keep on checking if it has collided. But the over-lifetime blocks, most of the times, we don't use them in the update particle. They are used down here in the fourth section, the output section, which is where we draw the particles. This is essentially the render when comparing to the particle system. We take care of the aspect of the particle. So why do we use the over-lifetime blocks down here? It's essentially a question of performance, of memory usage. How do we write or read particle data from the memory? The update particle section modifies stored particle data and then loads it again, and it keeps on doing that. It keeps on reading the particle data and modifying it and then loading again. It essentially keeps on updating the particle each frame. While on the output section, it doesn't store any modifications. It doesn't save the modifications. It simply modifies the existing data in the particle. That's the big advantage. For example, in the update particle, since it keeps on updating the particle, if we add, for example, add size over here with a very small number, it will keep on adding 0.1 each frame to the particle, to the size of the particle. That's why it keeps on getting bigger. I mean, if I use a very, very small value, you can see that in action. They become bigger throughout the end. While down here, if I use an add size, it only adds 0.1 to the size one time. It doesn't read and load the particle data and keeps on updating the particle data. That's the big difference down here. Another example of the update particle function is the possibility to keep on triggering events. In this case, when the particle dies, it triggers another particle system to spawn a child, to spawn a particle. And that child can inherit properties like position, color, and many others. But it also can have properties of its own, like in this case, the lifetime. These are essentially sub-emitters that we can see in the particle system. Sub-emitters in the particle system can emit another particle at birth, death, on collision, and so on. Let's look at another few comparisons. For example, in the particle system, we are using a shape so the particles spawn according to the geometry used here, which is a cone shape, and there's plenty of other shapes. In VFX Graph, the same thing happens. We just need to search for position or shape, and we will find blocks for that. In our case, we are using not a cone, but a sphere instead. But it is the same logic, a shape, a position, so the particle knows where to spawn. Another thing worth mentioning to enclose this video is, since VFX Graph communicates directly with the GPU, we don't need to create a bunch of materials like we do in the particle system. We have direct access to the shader instead, which is super useful because we can control values directly there. So that's it, a super lightweight comparison between VFX Graph and particle system. And I hope this video makes you feel a little bit more confident to use VFX Graph, or at least go from the particle system to VFX Graph a little bit more confident with this side by side. Let me know below if you have any questions, any doubts in the comments. I will try to help you out. And these videos are possible thanks to my patrons. A big thank you to each one of them. And if you want to support me and keep the channel alive, you will also get access to a huge library of visual effects that you can use in your games or study up close. And as usual, a quick shout out to the top tier patrons, which are 3D Sorcery, Alex Bick, Alexander Brazy, Alvman, Aviat Tobali, Axel, Bluebird, Bonehead, Kruby Dooby Doo, Cyber Cradle, Daniel Schmidt, Diaku, Diana Simonian, Dieg Marks, Duitron, Effect Yellow, El Sheriff, Easy, Fang Striker, Fairy Eye Online, Giri Andre, Giulio Bevenuti, Goblin Plague, Grub Lab, Guilherme Trindade, Gupanzu, Jason Marrero, Joseph Ballantyne, Casey Miller, Cabron Campi, Leanne Holtz, Lutuli, Lim Green, Luke Hammer, Lucas Rocha, Manuel Mora, Mehmet Chakush, Minazuki, Mosen and Safdar, Nicholas Morial, Oitzk, Pong, Pradip Sen, Radioactive Bullfrog, Revenant Games, Robert, R. Lee, Travis McCollum, Verisuta, Will Hughes, Will Pulliam, Yehoshua Villas, Dong Mao Dong, and Ching Pion Lee. Thank you all for your amazing support over the years and over the last month. You guys keep the channel going and you help me make these videos. I hope you have enjoyed these new type of videos, and I hope to see you on the next video. Thanks. Bye.